Father, today we are mindful of your goodness. We give you thanks for calling us into your life. We thank you that you've given us the life that you inherently have in yourself, and you've united us to yourself through the work of your Son and our Lord Jesus Christ. We are very mindful of your grace in our lives, that you've come to us when we were afar off. You reconciled us to yourself, and you made us to partake of Christ and to benefit of his work. And you have knit us together in your body, the church. Today we celebrate your grace, we celebrate your power, and as we continue, we ask for a rich blessing on our time, that our attention would be Godward, that our focus would be on you, and that in all things you would have the preeminence and that the credit would rightly be directed unto you. We ask that you would make this day a day where your faithfulness, your constant and unending love for your church, and all of your mercies, which are new every day, are remembered and celebrated above all else. We ask it through Christ and for his sake. Amen.
Can we all stand together?
Breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger. The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, who leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take my place, that you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. He brings our chaos back into order, makes the orphan a son and daughter. The King of glory, the King of glory, who rules a nation, truth and justice, comes like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love, that you would take place, that you would bear my cross. You laid down your life that I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Slain, worthy is a King who conquered the grave. Worthy is a Lamb who slain. Worthy is a King who conquered the grave. Worthy is a Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. You laid down your life. That I would be set free. Oh, Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. Higher than mountains that I face, stronger than the power of the grave, constant in the trial and the change. One thing remains, this one thing remains. Well, your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love. On and on. On and on and on and on it goes. It overwhelms and satisfies my soul. And I never, ever have to be afraid. This one thing remains. This one thing remains. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails. Never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me. Oh, your love. Your love. Your love never fails. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up. Never runs out on me. Oh, your love. In death and life, in death, in life, I'm confident and covered by the power of your. There's nothing that can separate my heart from your great love. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love. We celebrate, we praise the love of God. We lift you high, we lift you high. Oh, there's nothing like your love. Worthy is the Lamb. worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave.
Let's just worship Him worthy.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. You are worthy, worthy, worthy. Your love never fails. Oh, your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Your love never fails and never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love never fails, never gives up, never runs out on me. Oh, your love. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong, Savior's love.
Yes, Lord, we declare You the cornerstone, Christ alone. He is Lord. Jesus, we thank You that we can depend upon You, our foundation, our rock, our defender. And Lord, we're just reminded of that passage that You spoke and said how we ought to set our foundation upon the rock. That when the waves and storms of life come crashing, we won't be consumed, but Lord, we'll be upon the rock, our foundation firm in You. We thank You, Father, that Your name, the name of Jesus, is a strong tower that the righteous run to You and they're safe. Father, this is a day of celebration. So God, we celebrate You. We celebrate Your work through Your saints. In Jesus' name, amen.
In a moment, we're going to invite up each of the graduates to share briefly about some things that they've learned in their time as a Bible college student. Actually, most of them have been experiencing Bible college at other campuses as well, so the good stuff means it was here. If there's something negative, they got it somewhere else. But before we do that, a few things I want to say. Normally at this time, we would like to show a video of what the student life was like, but as we went through all the footage that they supplied us, we realized that it probably wouldn't be appropriate to show them dancing in the dorms to ABBA, although Inga Lil might like that. And so it's insufficient footage and inappropriate, perhaps. So to spare their embarrassment and our pain, we don't have that, but they will be getting one privately. I would also like to say before they come up and share that in the life of Generation Bible College, these students are going into a new season, and so is the school. We are transitioning to be a fully online school. And the reason I say that is that this is something we've seen on the horizon and that we have prayerfully approached, and we believe that God's hand is on. But what is very special about that is that I don't think that we could have ended one season to go into another with a better group of students. And I really do mean that, not just the ones that are graduating, but we have some very special students who aren't graduating today, but are very good people. And for us to have our final semester be one where there was no discipline that had to be meted out, and for the most part, I think I could say that we got by and we loved one another. No, we did. We had a great semester, and these students have been, in many ways, some of the most enjoyable and the easiest, and the fellowship and the relationship was true, natural, organic, spiritual, and biblical. And for me, that's a much better way to end the residential component of a Bible college. And I just feel it's fitting to say that we're not excited they're leaving. That they were a very real blessing to us at the Bible college and to the church as they served the church with their work service hours and the way that they got involved in different ministries. It has been a very real blessing, and we just want to be sure that we acknowledge that. Also, too, these students have been a joy because of their heart, but also their humor, and in a very remarkable way, their ability and desire for me as a teacher of more complicated subjects to think through difficult things and to wrestle with difficult concepts and to apply their mind to not just accept what they're fed, but to really go and wrestle with it in prayer and Bible study. And for me, that's just a wonderful thing to see. And so that's enough of that prelude. At this time, we're going to bring up the graduates one by one to give a short testimony. And so the first graduate that we're going to ask to come up is Santa Barbara native Cameron Baker. He doesn't know. He hasn't got his diploma yet, so I don't know. You get the handheld.
Handheld.
Yeah.
Hello.
I'm gonna sit here just in case say something appropriate. Okay.
All right. Well, I know we're all glad to be here, and we're excited that we got to finish out this semester in person. Because I know, what for me at least, I would not have wanted to do this online. So I'm really excited that we could be here and actually graduate in person. I went and I spent one semester in Murrieta, and then as I was on winter break back home here in Santa Barbara, I had the opportunity of working under Scott Dupar in the junior high program, which was awesome. And so I've been doing the last three semesters here in Santa Barbara. And it's interesting because the last 2 days, mostly just today and yesterday, the Bible College in Murrieta graduated. So they had their whole time where they went up and they got to shake the hands and do the diplomas. And I was sitting here thinking, and I saw a bunch of my friends that I met when I was in Murrieta, and they all got to graduate, and it was awesome. And I was like, oh, that's really cool. But looking at it, and there's something different about Santa Barbara. There's something different about being here at this campus and being able to have a little time where we can each come up here and speak and share part of our hearts. Because in Murrieta, I would have just already been done by now. I would have walked up, I would have shaken a few hands, and I would have walked off the stage and had my diploma. But here in Santa Barbara, with the smaller campus, with the intimacy of being able to know the teachers and being able to actually talk to them one-on-one so often, you know, we always have this opportunity to be in fellowship and to be so close to one another that it is truly something special. It's something that I don't believe I found at Murrieta, but I definitely found here. It's been such a blessing to be able to be here and just get to know the students and the faculty. And from me and from all the students, I just want to say thank you. Thank you to all the staff who were on stage, or not on stage, all the staff who are at the church, all the faculty of the school. We are so grateful for everything that you guys have done for us. I mean, the personal relationships we've been able to make with each of you has been life-changing. It's been really great. And what I would say is my favorite part about Bible college is when I meet somebody who I've never met, and because I'm college age, they ask me, what are you doing? Like, where do you go to school? What do you do? Oh, I'm at Bible college. They're like, oh, okay, cool. Like, what do you plan on doing that with that? And I'm always like, well, you know, it's not accredited. And they're like, ooh. Like, so you're going to a non-accredited fake college. Sweet, right? And so it's funny because people this day and age, and it makes sense, and I have nothing against secular school. That's great. I'll probably do that after this. But they always are looking to see what you're going to do next. Okay, you're taking this diploma, you're doing these classes, you're going to this college. What are you going to do next? Where are you going to go from here? And it's funny because once you tell them that this is non-accredited, that you're just doing it for your own personal growth and to grow in the Lord and to know Him more, they're kind of like, ooh, really? That's what you want to do? You just want to do that for the sake of it? I'm like, yeah. Because they don't always see the benefit of that. They're thinking, how are you going to go from here? Well, again, I just want to say for me and from all the students that I don't feel like there's anything I could have done better to prepare me for my future, to prepare me for what's coming next in my life. Because at Bible college, you get to grow with students and with teachers and learn so much more about the Lord. And that's greater than any school can offer. To have a deeper relationship with Christ Jesus, to know Him more, to know His word, and to know how to seek after Him. That's a priceless gift. And I feel like that's what I've received in my time here at Bible College. And I'm just eternally grateful to all of the staff, truly. And so I just want to say thank you for that. And in case you're wondering what I'm doing next, I'm gonna be staying here in Santa Barbara. And I'm going to be working with the junior high program and going from here. And I'm just super excited because through Bible College, I feel so much more equipped for that. I feel like I can actually go to the students and teach them something, right? I'm like, oh, the Nicene Creed, like, let's talk about it, right? All these different things, but also not only that cool aspect of knowing the Word, but also just having the aspect of knowing Him in my own life, having a closer, deeper relationship with Him than I ever have before this. And so I'm really excited for that and what's going to come next. And again, thank you. Thank you for everything that you have done. Thank you, Keith, for just being an awesome director. Again, when I went to Bible college, the director there was awesome, and I really liked him, but I never got to know him. My cap is falling off, but I never got to know him, and I didn't get to know him personally. I didn't get to know him on a real level and to actually know who he was because it was such a big school. I just couldn't talk to him. You know, you have to go through like 30 people to get to the director. But here, we got to know Keith. Keith was at all of our devotional sessions, talking to us, being with us. He would come over to the Bible college houses and like just dwell with us. And it's awesome. It's been so sweet to see. So for me, from all the students, we just want to say thank you. And we're excited to move on and go into this next season of life and whatever it may carry. We feel very equipped. We feel like we've been the most equipped that we could have possibly been going to any college, accredited or not. So. Thank you, and woo, we're excited.
Thank you, Cameron. Next, we have a very exciting graduate, Tefera, who has been with us for quite a while.
Thanks, kid. Hello. Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Tefera Bazu, and I'm so grateful for this wonderful and beautiful opportunity. And first of all, I'd like to thank God for this huge opportunity of studying His Word and to be equipped. So I'm so grateful for this one. And secondly, I'd like to thank the GBC teachers, staffs, and Director Keith, especially. Keith is not only the good teacher, he is also basketball coach. So he taught us, you know, he trained us how to dunk. So if you want, you know, play basketball, just join GBC, not only for studying Bible. Lastly, but not least, I'd like to thank you, my beautiful wife, just who supported and encouraged me to make it this study, and my 5-year-old son, who understood me to do my papers and study when I told him, my son, I'm studying. Okay, daddy. And he sacrificed, you know, many times his play time just for my study. So I'd like to thank him. And to tell, just to talk about Generation Bible College, GBC impacted my life, my understanding how to study Bible, how to approach Bible. My biblical world is completely changed after joining Generation Bible College. So the way how I used to approach Bible is not the same like, you know, right now how I study Bible. So really, generally speaking, it is the institute where my entire world got changed. Spiritual world is got changed. So I'm so grateful for studying in this wonderful campus. And and not only this one, so it initiated me to continue my study and, you know, to further study, because this is not maybe, this is, as Cameron said, maybe the beginning for everyone who joined the Bible study or Generation Bible College. This may be the opening the door. So it initiated me to continue and, you know, to go further. So I'm so grateful and thankful for just part of this wonderful Generation Bible College. So I know there is far further way to go in studying Bible, but I am confident that to share God's word proudly for, you know, in front of anyone after studying Bible in Generation Bible College, I am, you know, equipped to talk with people about the God's word and how to share God's word. So I am confident to share God's word with anybody after studying in Generation Bible College. Thank you so much, all the staffs and all teachers and Director Keith. So I'm so grateful. God bless you all. Thank you.
You're gonna have to teach me how you get your kid to leave you alone while you study, because we haven't got there yet. Okay, next we have Josiah Clark.
Hi, everybody. My name is Josiah Clark. This is my fourth semester of Bible college. And I'm graduating, so it would be wrong of me if I didn't begin by praising the Lord for not only getting me through Bible college, but getting me into Bible college. Because Bible college is certainly not something that I wanted to do, and it's certainly not something that I wanted to keep doing. But through the grace of God, it is something that I did. And so praise God for that. I would also like to thank my parents, who not only supported me financially through Bible college, but also emotionally and spiritually. And as many times as my mom texted me and just told me she was praying for me or called me and let me know, that just means so much to me. So thank you, Mom. So in Bible college, I did my first two semesters in York, England, which was the only reason I went to Bible college. My third semester I spent in Marietta, and my last semester I spent here. And this semester was really cool, and it was really different. Because of the fact that the school was so small, I got to be really close to my teachers, like Keith, like Jim Noe, different teachers that I've had, and it's been a really neat experience, and the Lord has really just changed my perspective on, I think, on most importantly, His Word, and just the divinity of His Word, and how amazing it is, and how everything's unified and put together, and I think that that is definitely the biggest thing that I've learned in Bible college. So again, I'd like to thank the staff here for getting to know us, and for putting the time and effort into getting to know us, and that means so much to me, and for letting us be a part of their ministries, and yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Josiah. And lastly, I don't know if you guys know, we're in the presence of royalty. So she demands I say Princess Shiloh Tartaglia.
I thought for sure I was going to fall coming up here. So when I very first started Bible college, I thought that by the end of it, I was going to be able to answer any tough question anybody asked me, and that when I prayed, it would sound so amazing, and that I'd be able to like lead these great small groups, and that it was just going to, you know, I was just going to have all the answers for everything. And then during one of my semesters in a chapel, one of the speakers said something that I'll never forget. He said, when you come to Bible college, you're going to learn a lot of things. But if you go home and you just go right back to where you were before, and you just start criticizing everyone, and you think that you know better than everyone, then you've completely wasted your time at Bible college. Because it's not about how much you know, it's about how much you love people. And the cool thing about Generation Bible College, when I switched here for my last semester, was that I feel like I really got to see Jesus' love in action just through the teachers, the staff, all of my friends and roommates. And I really got to learn about just how Jesus' love is what changes people and how it's the most important thing. So I just want to thank everyone here who is just awesome in encouraging me and supporting me, especially my parents. Thank you for all the times that you guys listened to me on the phone and were willing to encourage me and visit me, and to my sister for all the conversations that we've had and how encouraging you've been, and to my roommates for putting up with all my craziness, and to the neighbors for hearing me sing. Yes, that was me trying. I'm sorry that I sucked so bad. Lastly, I just want to thank Sidewalks for keeping me off the street.
Thank you, Shiloh. At this time, me as the director of the school, I am going to offer what is the final charge of the Bible College to them, and in this, it's really a chance for me to speak to the graduates. I would also say I extend this to everybody who's listening, and especially the students who aren't graduating. But I would like to speak to the graduates, and when I speak to them, I am essentially inviting everybody in here to kind of listen in onto what is maybe more of a private conversation, but given in a public form. And so in doing that, I'm going to be sharing from the book of Zechariah, and I see none of the student graduates have their Bibles, but that's okay. They know it by head, I guess, right? So, Zechariah chapter 4, and I'm going to read verse 6 through 10. That's a very familiar passage, and then I'm going to offer what is a final charge, which I hope is beneficial to these four and to everyone else. In verse 6, so he answered and said to me, "This is the word of the Lord to Zerubbabel, not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord of hosts. Who are you, O great mountain? Before Zerubbabel, you shall become a plain, and he shall bring forth the capstone with shouts of grace, grace to it. Moreover, the word of the Lord came to me, saying, the hands of Zerubbabel have laid the foundation of this temple. His hands shall also finish it. Then you will know that the Lord of hosts has sent me to you. For who has despised the day of small things? For these seven rejoice to see the plumb line in the hand of Zerubbabel. They are the eyes of the Lord which scan to and fro throughout the whole earth. This is God's word. Father, we thank you for revealing yourself to us and what you've done in history, for interpreting it and inspiring human authors to write it and then preserving it for our edification, for our instruction, and our benefit. We ask that now, as we think together about what you would say to us today, that you would cause each word to find its way effectively into the heart, and that that would be seen through lasting fruit. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, guys, I would like to speak to you today about the day of small things. Because as you leave here, you are going to be brought into a new realm or a new season of life. And there's one thing that I can say to you with certainty, is that it will be a new season, and it will be a season where you will have many occasion to experience what we might call small things, or the day of small things. Now, as I said to you all that are listening in on this, something that you should know is that each semester we prayerfully pick a theme from a Bible verse which we seek to emphasize each semester in our devotion time, and we seek to bring it from a theme into a principle into our lives that we seek to truly understand greater and live out more faithfully. And this semester's theme has come to us through the words of the Apostle Paul to the church in Philippi, when he says to them in chapter 3, forgetting the things which are behind, I reach forward and I press on toward the goal for the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. And what we've sought to do this semester is to latch onto that phrase, press on, and to understand how it speaks to us in our present situations. And essentially, the idea was this: keep going. Keep going. It was said of Martin Lloyd-Jones, certainly one of the best preachers of the last century, that as he would shake people's hands as they were leaving Westminster Chapel in London, that he would simply offer these words: keep going. Keep going. And that is what we have sought to emphasize. Now, the words of God through Zechariah to Zerubbabel in many ways echo that very same sentiment. It is a word of encouragement to a man who had begun a massive task to rebuild the temple, a temple that had been destroyed, and yet for all of that had come to a place where he was experiencing opposition from without, an apathetic attitude from within the people of Israel, and by virtue of the size of the task, it was very possible for Zerubbabel to look at all of these factors and to conclude that it wasn't worth it. And so Zerubbabel very likely was on the precipice of entering into a state of discouragement and despair and despondency, and perhaps even depression. All of these things certainly would have been weighing on his mind and on his heart as he sought to do what he knew God had called him to do, yet everything that were in his immediate circumstances were directly and powerfully and daily opposed to these things. And thus God, through the prophet, speaks to him in order to encourage him to be comforted, to take heart, and to continue doing the work. Even though, as he says in verse 10, this is a day of small things. And so he encourages him with three things, which we'll examine later. But in the first place, he says to him in verse 6, not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit. He says to him, I will supply the power that you need. I will supply the strength that you need. It will be me effectively working through you. In the second place, he is assured of the fact that God is aware of the opposition. He says to him very clearly that there are mountains that will become plains. In other words, he says, the huge obstacle in front of you will not remain. And then he says, you have not only begun the work, you've laid the foundation of the temple, verse 9, his hands shall also finish it. This would have been a tremendously encouraging word to a man who had a very important duty, who was opposed from without, opposed from within, and God comes alongside through the prophetic vision, and he says, walk in my strength, I'm aware of your obstacles, and I will continue and complete that which you have started. Now, it is about this day of small things that I want to talk to you about, though. Because the fact of the matter is, as great as the work is, you are going to experience such days. Now, let me just say here at the very beginning, before you think that this is kind of a bummer, everything I'm about to say to you, God is entirely for you, demonstrated through the suffering and resurrection of his Son. God is entirely for you, and he is always with you. And I would love for you, and I want you to understand that he is big, massive, and he inhabits all things. He is all in all, and he fills all in all. He is for you, he is with you, he is behind you, and he is going before you, and he is the power at work within you. And I want you to have a big vision for your life. I want you to believe big things. And I want you to know that God's dreams for your life are far bigger and far greater and far more powerful and beautiful and every other adjective we could think of than yours. Yet for all of that, I also want you to approach things with a soberly perspective. Because the fact of the matter is you are going to have days of small things. Now, I know that you may be thinking, I just did have a lot of days of small things. It's called M199. It's called Chuck Tracks when you had to do those, and I know you're very thankful that we didn't do those anymore. And it's called finishing up all these classes. Now I'm ready to go and to plant a church, which will be a mega church, and Christianity Today is going to talk about us a lot. I'm going to have an Instagram cult following. And yes, I am going to be writing a book, and I'll be a best-selling author. Gospel Coalition is going to want me to blog. We'll see what my travel schedule is like and all of that. I assure you, it doesn't work that way. The fact of the matter is, you are going to leave here, and you are called to live out a life of faithfulness in what is a long, slow, difficult, and grinding out realities of day-to-day Christ-following discipleship. Welcome to your life. And I say this because at times things are going to seem slow, very slow. And at times things are going to seem pointless and purposeless, suffering and pain and heartache and setbacks and sins and besetting sins. And in all of these things, you are to keep going. Now, I want you to take encouragement from God's word to Zerubbabel in the appropriate measure. But I want you to know that you will have the day of small things. Or as the song put it, Mama said, there'd be days like this. There'd be days like this, Mama said. What's she saying? I was thoroughly prepared for what I'm going through. And that is what we're seeking to say today. And so I want to first of all suggest to you or say to you under three headings why it is that we don't like the day of small things, why we need the day of small things, and then how it is that we can endure the day of small things. So in the first place, I'd like to speak to you about why don't we like the days of small things? Well, I don't think it takes a rocket scientist to figure that one out, because if we're honest about this whole thing, none of us hear such things and say, yes, I'm very excited for the day of small things. As a matter of fact, I have been looking forward to the day of small things, and they are the most exciting thing that I could think of on my horizon. No, not at all. When we say small things, we're talking about when things are slow, when there's a lot to do and a little time. And it's the things that are not exciting. It's the things that are grinding and toilsome and hard, and there's lots and lots of work, and there's little time, and there's very little visible results, yet nonetheless, you are right in the midst of what you are supposed to do. I'm talking about those type of days, because those are the type of days that await you beyond these halls. And if you think about it, we are naturally disposed to avoid these, aren't we? Wouldn't we much prefer the fast track to success? Somebody told me, because I never dress like this, and you guys can attest to that. Cameron, you always dress like that, kind of, but it's okay. So somebody told me I looked like a motivational speaker, like a kind of get-rich guru, right? That's what we want. Don't tell me that I'm going to have to fight and suffer and endure through hard things. Rather, just give me the formula. 5 steps, that's what I want. I'll even buy the hardback, not just the Kindle, as long as you could guarantee success in that. But the fact of the matter is, that's not the way that it is. Not at all. And let me suggest to you a few reasons why we do not like the day of small things. Because it's hard. It's difficult. It's not fun. It's taxing. And it requires effort. It involves pain. It involves sacrifice, sleepless nights. Our weaknesses are exposed. Our selfishness is exposed. Our flesh is exposed. Our utter inadequacy is exposed. And then to top it all off, what do? We begin to look around and compare ourselves with other people and say, well, this isn't fair at all, God. Because why is it that this person over here seems to do so little and get so much? And then we forget the fact that they've had to go through the long process as well. And ultimately, it doesn't matter what God is doing with that person. What matters is what God is doing with you and what he's seeking to teach you in your own peculiar day of small things. But the main reason I think that we don't like those days is because they're slow. And we are an insanely impatient people. Millennials, this sociologists say, are impatient. I've come to realize I am a millennial because I was born in 1990. Let me just say, I think you guys are millennials. I'm not sure what you are. As a matter of fact, thinking about it, I think we spent the better half of the last 3.5 months just trying to figure out what you guys are. And we're looking at you, what are these things? They're Bible college students. Well, let me talk to you about statistics for millennials. Asha Sharma, writing on Forbes.com, cites a Pew Internet and Family Life Project, and this is what she says about the millennial generation. We expect instant gratification, and we are the generation who is always on. That is, we are always connected to something, technologically speaking. Matter of fact, some of you are probably on your phones right now. And then she goes on to say, by the way, Snapchats. I saw some of those Snapchats. Gross. Okay? That's just for you guys just to know what I think about those things. Secondly, this is what she says. Between now and 2020, experts predict that this generation will exhibit, okay, 2020, that's not far away. This generation will exhibit a thirst for instant gratification, quick fixes, a loss of patience, and a lack of deep thinking ability. A loss of patience, a lack of deep thinking ability. Because we can't sit around in a circle and talk, but we'd rather Snapchat. The dumbing down of our generation is very real. We're impatient. And all of this leads us to the place where we're impatient. One author said this, "This generation is in a hurry. They really don't think they have the time to wait. They want to make a difference, but they want to make it now." Now, that's a good thing. You want to make a difference, and you want to be quick about it. But there is the qualification. This generation doesn't think they have the time to wait. In other words, they haven't learned what it means to be patient and wait on God's timing, and to learn what is called the long obedience in the same direction. And our culture, friends, is in a mad, chaotic frenzy. They're in a hurry, busy about being busy, and that's all there is to it without any explanation. I'm just busy. Not even any time to think about these things. As a matter of fact, some of the family who's visiting California, you might be thinking, I guess the stop signs here are just for decoration because nobody's really stopping at these things. No. We are a culture that is in a mad rush and living at a very unhealthy and rapid pace. And the consequence of this is that it brings anxiety, it brings stress, and it brings uncertainty, and we have lost our ability to appreciate things that come slow and long. I'm stepping out on a limb here, but if I could quote the prophet Ferris Bueller, perhaps, he says, life moves by pretty fast. You might miss it if you don't slow down and watch once a while. Enjoy the journey. Enjoy your life, and don't get caught up in the busyness of things. Unfortunately, the American church culture doesn't provide you with many opportunities to do what I'm saying. We're at a frantic pace at times, and younger people expect more, and they expect it quicker. But that's not really how God works. Because activity doesn't necessarily equal productivity, does it? And you might get a lot of stuff quick, and you might do a lot of stuff quick. But a good question would be, was it God's work, done God's way, in God's time, for God's name? The days that seem slow and insignificant, where nobody is giving you any attention, no Twitter mentions, no public praise, it's pointless, it's purpose, it's not glorious, and the only sound that you hear concerning you is the sound of the keys on your belt because you've got janitor keys and you got to clean church all the time or whatever else it is. The days of small things are a definite and certain reality, and what we've been doing this season in your life is preparing you not for immediate, visible, outward success, but faithfulness. To live out the Christian life to the very end. A long obedience in the right direction. Now, why do we need the day of small things? As James Boyce put it, any worthwhile work begins small and progresses to be bigger. That's just the way that it works. Spurgeon, and I'm going to spare you the whole long quote, but Spurgeon puts it like this, God begins great works with small things. God begins great works with small things. And then he references a seed being sowed in the garden, which over time becomes a beautiful rose. Nobody likes seeds, but everybody likes roses. Now the farmer doesn't look at the day of sowing the seed and say, this is slow and insignificant and small and pointless. But he understands the process. And without the day of small things, we lose appreciation of the big things. We need the day of small things because they provide us with the right perspective of how God works and a sense of accomplishment and appreciation of these things that have come through much work and patience. And in the day of small things, it is in those days that we are learning valuable life lessons. because character is carved in the crucible of faithful endurance, enduring opposition, enduring the world, the flesh, and the devil, and living faithfully, relying on the grace that Christ Jesus abundantly supplies. And without the day of small things, our sense of dependence on God is completely lost, because we begin to think that we're able in and of ourselves to achieve these things. And I'm going to tell you right now, that is dangerous. It is extremely dangerous to get too much too quick. I'm going to say that again. It is extremely dangerous to get too much too quick. And so we are called to expect the day of small things, to embrace the day of small things, and to endure the day of small things. And let me tell you, some of your best memories are going to come from them. As a matter of fact, mothers, the memories of the children of being up all night and changing diapers, there's a certain agony if you think about that happening again, isn't there? But yet there's also a certain thing that you cherish about these things. The day of small things, and you look back on those memories, and you begin to cherish those things because of the journey that you were able to walk. And another reason we need the day of small things is because if we're honest about this, we don't have all the knowledge. We don't know everything that God is doing. We don't know everything that God has planned and how he's working and how he's going to bring it about. During my time in Germany, I taught a small Bible study in a city called Neuwied, which was a good close to two-hour drive from where we lived in Siegen. Okay? This is Germany. That means you got to drive through what is called the Westerwald, the West Forest. Snow, dark roads. You have to wipe the window every 20 seconds, it seems, because of fog and how you can't see through the window. And so we would do this every week. We would drive 2 hours to Neuwied, take a little group of people. We prayed beforehand. And then we get here to do this Bible study, and we walk in, and I'm going to tell you guys, this was the most chaotic Bible study I think that ever there was in the history of mankind. I mean, you never knew what was going to happen. You don't even know if people are going to be there. Then if they're there, you don't even know if they're really going to be checked in. And week in and week out, I would drive to this place. And then here in the middle of the Bible study, you have this Italian who thinks he's Paco Rabanne, and that's actually his name, Paco. And during the middle of the Bible study, he thinks it's a good idea to ask the girls, hey, let's go smoke a cigarette out on the balcony. And then the arguments start happening, and, you know, it's Germany, and there's Turkish people and Italian people, and there's us, you know, dumb Californian Americans who don't even know Spanish. So they get going arguing in German, and then, man, I'm telling you, when the arguments in Turkish start happening, then you knew something was really wrong. Then you got girls locking themselves in the bathrooms and hiding from everybody, people on the balcony smoking, people out, I don't know what they were doing outside, trying to get into the bathroom to talk to the sister, and then you got people arguing over here, then you got people over here that don't even care, and I just drove 2 hours through the Westerwald. I'm going to tell you, the Westerwald is not fun. And here I am thinking, what in the world is going on in this place? Am I either the worst pastor, Bible teacher, leader, intern, whatever my title was? I just want to teach you people the Bible. I mean, can we just get through one night where we actually go through the Bible and I get to feel like I've actually done something? That was a day of small things. Now, I at times did not want to go. But I'm going to tell you that it was through that family that hosted it that invited me to Turkey. Go to Turkey. Meet a girl named Besta. Ask her out the same day I met her, and of course she says yes. I'm sorry, I just can't tell that story without making it. It's true though, right, honey? Her voice is out, so I can do that, right? You don't know what God is doing in the day of small things, and you don't want to miss out. And the fact of the matter is, we need them, because they are about what God is doing in your life, and he is painting the mosaic of your life in each one of those days and preparing you and doing things in you that, listen, He couldn't have done otherwise. So how do we endure the day of small things? It's not a question, are you going to face them? The question is, how will you approach them? Well, I think that what God said to Zerubbabel is fitting. Not by might, nor by power, but by my spirit. For Zerubbabel, who was probably ready to throw in the towel, the word was, rely on the strength that God provides. You see, you need to walk in the power that he gives. You have to live life in a posture of dependence, knowing that in and of yourself, you are completely inadequate and insufficient and unable to do these things. So stay near to Jesus, rely on him, and live in the power that he provides. Secondly, recognize that you will have opposition. You will have your own peculiar mountains, your own particular mountains that you'll face. You will have difficulties and setbacks, because nothing worthwhile comes without opposition. Don't shrink back from that, but understand that walking in God's strength, you can survive. And then remember God's promises. You see, God told Zerubbabel, you've started this thing and you will finish it. God will complete the work that he began in you in those days, and he will perfect that which concerns you. You will have the day of small things. So you walk in the strength that he provides, you recognize that it won't be easy, and you remember that he will complete his work in you. Let me say in closing two things. This is hard, what I'm about to tell you to do, because I thought I was going to be able to do it moving from Germany to here, and I haven't. Keep it simple. Keep it simple. Our lives in America are so full of clutter, and it's in the church. Keep it simple. And I'd like to end with a quote from J. Edwin Orr in his book, Can God, so that you're encouraged when you leave. Little things have big futures, especially when they are committed to God. I think we could say, days of small things have big futures, especially when they are committed to God. Let me pray. Father, we thank you that you're not limited by the things that we would imagine you are, that your strength is not affected by our weakness, but rather perfected in it. We thank you, Lord, that Christ himself had days of small things to give significance to ours. We ask that you would teach us what it means to be a faithful disciple in every circumstance of life. That you would teach us how to deal with heartache, pain, failure, setbacks, difficulties, and that you would teach us how to tap into the life that you've abundantly provided and that we benefit from. We ask Christ that you would perfect that which concerns your sheep, because we are utterly confident that they hear your voice, that they know you, and that they follow you. We pray this in the strong name of Jesus, the chief shepherd. Amen. So at this time, we're now going to confer the degrees upon the students, and so I'm going to ask Pastor Drew Kwiecki, who serves as the Dean of Men, to come up, and he will read the names. Pastor David Guzik, Inga Lil, and my wife Besta, we will all be up here to congratulate them. And Justin's going to be down here taking pictures, but if you want, when they get their degree, you can take a picture of them as they come up. So, yes, Drew?
Cameron Baker. Tafera Bezu. Josiah Clark. Shiloh Tartaglia.
You guys want to get, I don't know, a picture of them all together? No, not me. What are you looking at me for? Yeah, you guys come on up here.
Give the thoughtful.
So at this time, what we're going to do is ask students to now get off the stage and come down here. And what we invite anybody who wants to come and lay their hands on them. Pastor David and I are going to pray for them, and we'd love it if you'd like to join us down here in the front. And then after that, Pastor David will close us with a few words and a benediction. Father, we thank you that you are so kind to your people. We think of the words of the psalmist that if you counted transgressions, who could stand? And we're mindful of the fact that each one of them was imputed to Christ on our behalf in order that we could be brought into a right standing with you and to know you, and to be redeemed, and to be given a life that is beyond our wildest dreams. We thank you for the life that is represented here. We thank you for the faithfulness of parents that is represented here to teach their children the ways of Christ. And we thank you that it is your work. We ask for a very rich blessing upon each graduate. We pray not only for their sakes, Lord, but because we know that there's lives that you want to touch through them. There's work you want to do through them. And there's good things you want to bring into your world through them. And so we commit them to you. We ask that you would keep them, that you'd hold them close, that you'd fill them to the brim and overflowing with your precious Holy Spirit. We thank you that you've been providing for them beyond this season. And so we pray for a great measure of faith, a great measure of discernment and discipline, and that they would be committed Christ followers in all things. We ask, Lord, that in all that they do, in all that they endeavor, that your name would be sanctified, that you would lead them, and that you would fulfill all their joy in Christ Jesus, their Lord.
Father, we thank you for this milestone in the lives of these four graduates, as well as thanking you for every student who's completed another semester. Father, these milestones are important because they mark not only their effort, their persistence, their endurance, their hard work, but Lord, it also especially marks your faithfulness in and through them. For both of these, Lord, we are very grateful. And we pray that for each of these four graduates, as well as every student who has attended Generation Bible College this semester, we pray, God, that you would thoroughly ruin them for anything less than a life lived full on for Jesus Christ. Fulfilling in every aspect, God, the calling and gifting you've given them. So work it out, work it through them, Lord. Thank you. Thank you for the gift of such a great semester, such wonderful graduates, and such a beautiful time with the students this year. We praise you for it, Lord, and ask for your blessing upon these graduates in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Okay. All right. So you just want me to end it?
Sure. Yeah. I forgot to say something about those staff.
Yeah, I will. Please have a seat, and I'll just have a few remaining words. First of all, it's entirely appropriate for us just to recognize the staff or the teaching staff here at Generation Bible College. So if any time within the last year or two you've taught a class here at the Bible College, just stand up. We want to recognize you and thank you. Yes. David, Drew, that's... I want to give particular thanks to Jim Noh, who's been such a great teacher and such a wonderful part of our Bible College. Thank you. But it's also completely appropriate for us to give some special thanks and recognition to Besta Fortenberry and all her hard work as registrar. Please stand up, Besta. Thank you, Besta. And to this guy beside her, her husband, whatever his name is. Yeah. Thank you, Keith. Keith, thank you for your wonderful job, for your heart, your vision, all that you've poured into this. You and Besta both have been an amazing team for the work of this Bible College. And on behalf of the staff and the students, we just say thank you. Thank you so much. You can have that real satisfaction at the end of every semester of a marking point that says, another good semester in the books. It's a satisfying feeling, and you should enjoy it. It's well deserved. I also do just want to say, before I grant a benediction here at the end, that we have a reception in the high school room, which is just sort of behind me over here. If you don't know where it is, we'll help you find where it is. That means food, if you didn't know, reception. That means food. So, on your program, it says that we end here with a benediction. And benediction, if you didn't know, that's kind of a Latin way of saying a blessing. And it's a real joy to pronounce a blessing over all of you. I want to give special thanks to the family. Some of you have traveled a long way to be here, and I think it's a wonderful thing for you to participate in this for your family, for your sons and daughters. It's a wonderful thing. So let me pronounce a blessing. Father, in the name of Jesus, thank you for blessing the work of Generation Bible College. And Lord, now in your precious name, I want to pronounce a blessing according to the heart and the will of Jesus over these students, over these graduates, over these family, over these staff. Lord, every one of them has had a part in your great work over the past semester and over the past years. And so, Lord, we say, the Lord bless you and keep you and make his face to shine upon you. May the Lord God lift up the light of his countenance on you and be gracious to you, blessing you with every spiritual blessing in the heavenly places in Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen. Amen.